My name is Chad Michael St-Pierre. I'm here to introduce myself here on my first video here. I am a French-Canadian, of course, knowing from my last name, St-Pierre. And as well, I was born on November 24, 1984, at Yokota Air Base Hospital in Fusa, Tokyo, Japan. The reason why I was born in Japan is because my father was in the United States military. He was a Marine. He enlisted into the Marine Corps on the 27th of March of 1979. And he got out of boot camp around the time when October of 79. And he became a private first class. And then, after he got out of boot camp, like, soon, he was assigned to the 1st Tank Battalion, 1st Marine Division, and he was transferred to Camp Pendleton, California, where he was promoted to Lance Corporal in December of 79. And realizing that the Marine Corps command needed to send a Marine over to to Okinawa, Japan, my father volunteered to go over there, and he was sent to Okinawa, Japan. He was sent to the 9th Engineer Support Battalion, where he was promoted to corporal mysteriously in January of 1981. In April 1981, Corporal St-Pierre was transferred to the Wing Transportation Squadron in 37th at El Toro, California. This is where he was promoted to sergeant in February of 1982. By the time 1982 came along, when he was when he became a sergeant, he became he decided to change his occupational specialty in the Marine Corps by going for 3441, the audit technician field, where he was accepted, and then he was sent to Quantico to train as an auditor for a couple of years. And when his 2-year training was requirement was completed, he was transferred to Iwakuni, Japan. And he was transferred there in August of 1984, which by that time he had married my mom on the 25th of June of 1983, the year prior. And then around that exact time, my mom was pregnant with me, and she went over to Iwakuni, pregnant with me, and then I was born over there at the Yokota Air Base Hospital, right up there at Yokota Air Base, near the city of Tokyo, and that area called the city of Gyuza, in the Tokyo Prefecture, which is near Tokyo, of course. And Iwakuni is down there near, in between Hiroshima and Nagasaki, in Japan. And they go all the way up to Yokota to give birth to me, so don't know why they had to do that, or they had to be born up in Yokota instead of Iwakuni, so please don't ask, I don't know. And then my dad was promoted to staff sergeant in during November of 1986. He then received the Navy Marine Corps Achievement Medal for his achievements, and he in August of 1987 he was accepted for a staff non-commissioned officer's degree completion programs prior to graduation with honors for Columbine. We were around August 87 is when we were transferred to Quantico, or he went back to Quantico, and it was my first time living there. We were in Quantico for 2 years, but when we were living there, we did not live on base. We lived in a townhouse. We first lived in a townhouse in Dale City, and then we lived in a townhome. Then we moved into a townhome in Fredericksburg, in the Falmouth area of Fredericksburg, and sometime in 1988. Then in 1988, my dad was inducted into the Alpha Sigma Lambda Honor Society for academic excellence, and was selected for one officer. And then around that time he was promoted to one officer in February of 1989. So then he attended a basic school, Quantico, Virginia, from February to May of 1989. And then in June 1989, when Officer St-Pierre was next assignment, was at the NAF specialist at MCAS Cherry Point, North Carolina. And then in February 1991, my dad was promoted to Chief. chief, one officer, two. And then, in July of 1993, he had the Marine Corps had my dad transfer to Yuma, Arizona, where we lived for 2 years. We lived in North Carolina for four, of course, from 89 to 93. Then was while at Yuma in October of 1994, he was promoted to Chief One Officer 3. And while over there, he was then he was selected to for the ballot for captain in Camp Pendleton. Where in and December of 1995 he was promoted to captain, and around that time in December of 96 he received his business administration degree in for a master's, and in August 1998 we then had to transfer back here to Quantico for our second time, a third time for him. So. And then, during May 1999, he earned a certificate, internal, auditor professional, designation. And, became a licensed certified accountant in May of 2000. And then on February 1st, 2002, he retired from the Marines. And then a year after, on July 5th, of 2003, he committed suicide, and he has been passed on for going on 11 years by the time July comes around. And during his life he did get a bachelor's degree at the University of Maryland, and then his master's degree was from City University at Bellevue, Washington. So, my father is buried at a veterans cemetery called Rhode Island Veterans Memorial Cemetery in the city of Exeter, Rhode Island. And also, we had a memorial brick dedicated to him at the Marine Corps Museum right here at Quantico. So, that's basically it about my father. Can see right here. This is a scrapbook that my grandmother made for us to have, where it has photos of his childhood, all that, but the picture right here that I have on the front is a sketch portrait of my direct ancestor, Pierre de St-Pierre, Edichon. Pierre is my direct ancestor from my father's side, and he is the man that brought my St-Pierre family to North America from France. So, also, I have to say that on my mother's side, we happened to be somehow related to Celine Dion. It turns out that I'm her 10th cousin once removed. She is my parents' 10th cousin, since my dad and my mom have found that they are 9th cousins through my mom's direct line, through a man named Oswald Bellanger Jr., who marries Marie Marlon Guillaume, the daughter of Jean Guillaume de Busson Sr., who happens to be Celine Dion's direct ancestor, unfortunately. And also, also on my mom's side, there we have a cousin of mine that was a Hollywood producer. He was actually the executive producer for the original Dukes of Hazzard, of course. His name's Paul Picard. And how I know this is because my mom always remembered hearing her mother saying that that her cousin was the executive producer for Dukes of Hazzard, and she used to always brag about that, and we have some bragging rights that my grandmother's cousin was the executive producer for the Dukes of Hazzard. And also, I have right here let me open it and show it out. This happens to be a very old projector that belongs to Paul's Uncle Leonard, who happens to be my great-grandfather. And, of course, I have no idea how old it is, so, but I know it's older than my mom, of course, because it looks like it is, but my guess, it's probably from the 20s or 30s or something, I don't know, I'm not sure, because this thing doesn't even have a year on it. doesn't show anything that has a year on it that tells me how old it is. So, yeah, this projector was my great grandfather's, who also is, the uncle of Paul Picard, because Paul Picard's father, Romeo, happens to be an older brother of my great-grandfather, and because my great-grandfather, Leonard, was born on Halloween, 31st of October of 1904, and I also have a bunch of photos with him and with Romeo and my great-grandfather Leonard and my great-great-grandfather Albert, who's Paul's grandfather. And you would see that that Paul's grandfather, my mom's great-grandfather, and my great-great-grandfather, he had a leg amputated where he was in his later life, and he is sitting in a wheelchair. So, I'm pretty much a good person all along, though. I've had made a lot of mistakes that I am not very proud of, and I have to tell the truth about it here, because at one point I did, back in 2009, get arrested for a hit and run and obstruction of justice and conspiracy. Since I wasn't really doing this willingly, but I was just doing it because I was doing what my ex-girlfriend told me to do, because she told me to go ahead and lie to the judge about who was the driver of the car and everything when I hit that car in the parking lot by mistake. And also, she was also the one that made me leave the scene without calling the police, because she has a really bad reputation with the cops, and she doesn't like them at all, and told us to leave without calling the police, and she unfortunately was holding my phone at the time, and I was kind of powerless to actually stop it from happening, and but there have been some new evidence coming out that when I was doing this, I was not in my right mind, because they have confirmed something that I have had since I was born that I never knew that I had, which means I was diagnosed with a mild case of cerebral palsy. Back when I was 2 years old, I was diagnosed as being developmentally delayed. And when I was 8, I was diagnosed with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, or ADHD, in which I was for a long time, and since when I was about 13, I was about 85, 90 pounds or so, and at 4'11", and I was like, my appetite wasn't good, so they realized that the Ritalin was stunning my growth and changing my appetite. And so my psychiatrist took me off of the Ritalin and put me on another ADHD meds called Wellbutrin, in which I was taking from the time I was 13 to 14 and 15, wherein I stopped. I didn't take it anymore when I was in high school. And I did graduate high school in 2004, and I was 19. At the time, and like 19, almost 20, so, and the reason for that is because I was held back in elementary school, where right after kindergarten they made, put me in a transitional first grade class called T1, for sure. Transitional first grade is the long version. Of course, during that year at MT1, my class did get into the local newspaper, because we won the Spirit Stick Award, and we got able to do a picture with three cheerleaders from the Havelock High School when I went to Havelock Elementary School down in Northern North Carolina. And also during that year, we also did a Thanksgiving play for the school. For Thanksgiving, in which I have a video here, right here in my closet, and another thing is a little bit about, more about myself is that I also love to do genealogy work, and I love so much that I actually have been wanting to be a genealogist for my career, my professional one. And I'm kind of unemployed right now and having a difficult time controlling my disabilities because I'm still trying to learn more about them and to help myself to be able to control them. So I am having a difficult time kind of controlling it. And another thing a little bit about my hair, as you can see, when I was 18, I started losing my hair. It started falling out when I was 18. And it was thinning out and just falling out and waking up with hair on my pillow every morning. And when it started, I went, oh my gosh, am I really losing my hair here? So, and unfortunately, it just kept the hair from the back here, but the hair up on the top kind of is pretty much, as you can see, is gone. Also, with the cerebral palsy, I was actually diagnosed with that when I was about 27. And when I was 26, I had my first seizure. My first and only seizure, pretty much, and I do get pain a lot in my my back, and I just recently had to go to the hospital to for something where I had strained a muscle in my back or something, and it was really, really painful, and now, ever since they gave me some medication to help the pain and everything, it's pretty much getting better, of course. And also, I am an avid supporter into ending bullying, because I was bullied when I was a little boy, school from fourth through high school, fourth grade to high school. Had a couple of kids. Tease me or something. And I don't really like bullying all that too much because I think it's unacceptable behavior from other people. It's, to me, it's very unacceptable. I also believe that bullying should stop. And I say that because I know what it feels like to be bullied. Feelings when I was being teased in school, and also I'm a very true to heart Christian. I believe that religion never saved anyone, but Jesus saved us all from all tyranny, and all religion does is that we worship Jesus and God. But it doesn't save you unless you follow direction, follow Yahweh's directions, and on all of his commandments, and follow Jesus throughout your life as you put it together. All you have to do is just take all of Yahweh's commandments and make sure you get to doing them and obeying them 24/7, and obeying by following Jesus, who is the one that can give salvation. When I saw this bumper sticker once, and it says, "Religion never saves anyone, but Jesus saves," I actually thought, that's a nice bumper sticker, so I actually bought it, and I have it put onto my pickup truck that I drive. Because I drive a 2003 Ford pickup truck, Ford Ranger, and I do a lot
family history will. Because I'm pretty much, very much into it. And I have here a little something that of historical thing for the St-Pierre family. It's I get it from Wikipedia off the internet, and this tells me that the original the claim that the original genealogist's English claim is that the first St-Pierre first St-Pierre's were of original Norman Vikings. So that tells me that I am actually directly descended through the Norman Vikings. And also it tells us here that that our descendants, that their descendants had accompanied William the Conqueror during his en route to his victory at the Battle of Hastings in 1066. So it's telling me here that my ancestors were with William the Conqueror at the time of Battle of Hastings, and he got his victory there. Also, it tells us that our ancestral home is in Gouy, Normandy, France, and one of the the St-Pierre's who lived in Gouy, they lived in Gouy for over 271 years prior to the arrival of Pierre in Canada, because Pierre, of course, is the one that brought us to Quebec, Canada, so. And, that was between 1393 to 1664. So, prior to the arrival of Pierre, he's probably approximately 8 generations. Unfortunately, we cannot with certainty back over 4 generations back, because we will still try. They're saying that they're still going to try looking up, move up to the tree, but they still say that they cannot get many of the records, since a lot of the records were destroyed during the wars between that France was in with England and throughout the history of the French nation. So, my family did leave France during the time of the reign of King Louis XIV, because King Louis XIV was king, and my ancestors started coming over to the New France area. And many of my ancestors were from my female ancestors. Many of them were one of the thousand women that King Louis sent over as immigrant brides, which they called them the La Fille de Roi, which is, means the daughters of the king. So, and one of them was a woman named Catherine Bayonne. She came over from the Île-de-France area. She's from the Île-de-France near Paris. She is a from a rich noble family, a minor nobility family. Her father was a lord. Her father was the Lord of Maserati and the Lord of Valence in France. So, and her mother's family was also through lords as well. One of her direct her mother's direct ancestor was a man named Thomas de Mau or de Poissy. He was the Lord of Poissy in the de Mau. He was also they say that he was also the Count of Compiègne, is what they say. And they say that this man was a very brutal and a brutal, evil man, because he tortured and killed men for a living. He did fought in the First Crusade, but at one point his father tried to lock him up in a castle for eternity, which it did not work so well, because he realized that there was some areas of the thing that the barriers that they were putting up to keep them in was not all the way up. The stands were up, but the barriers that would cover it had not been put up yet. So he realized that, okay, now this is a chance that I can escape from this. So one night he actually did escape from the castle, and I don't know what castle it was, I don't remember, You're gonna probably have to look him up and read it. Maybe it'll tell you about it. But it'll tell you also a lot about this man and everything that he did. And to tell you the truth here, the history that they are saying about this man is that he hung men by their testicles and allowed the weight of their body to rip them off. Or he would, as he was hanging them up by that, he would stand underneath them and beat them with cuticles. And it got so bad that King Louis the VI had to ask another man called Raoul the Valiant to get his men to go in and go into Crecy to capture and kill Thomas to stop him from the torture that he was doing over there in Crecy. So Raoul the Valiant actually did come in. He injured Thomas so badly that he lingered for a month or so and then he died from his wounds afterwards in 1130 AD. And then his son took over after him. Thomas's son took over the lordship after him, and it turned out that his son was married to second cousin or something to King Louis the VII. And he was a really vicious man. When I found that I am actually descended by this man, I went, wow, am I really descended by this man? Because I couldn't believe that I was actually descended by a vicious man who did those type of things to other men. And it came to a point that even a lot of men actually were afraid to fight him and everything. It was really big. And also, one of the other ancestors that I have married into Thomas's family, like years on forward, probably like in the 14th, 15th centuries. But with a woman by the name of Antoinette Laurier, she had an ancestor who was her direct ancestor, Jean Ferrier, who was a knight, a French knight during the time of the French, the Hundred Years' War between France and England, like during the beginning of the war, and he married a woman named Marie Marcel. And Marie Marcel was the daughter of a man named Etienne Marcel. And it turns out that I am also descended by this man as well. And Etienne has a statue in his, a memorial statue in his dedication up over in Paris. It's a big statue that's in front of Hotel de Ville, which is some blocks away from Notre-Dame-de-Paris. And that man is also my ancestor, and also I have also found ancestry through the French royal family, the Capetian kings, through the Capetians and the Carolidians, that also leads up to the Merovingian kings, like all the way back is the French kings from the Capetians and the Carolidians all descend through the family of the Merovingians in some way or another of what I have found. And in one spot I have found that Charlemagne is, in one spot, is descended by King Clovis the First, who is the first French king to unite the kingdom of the Franks together as one Frankish kingdom. As we were in different kingdoms at that time, you know, split, and there was different kings, and his kingdom was the first of the Salian Franks, because his father was the king of the Salian Franks, and his father was the King Childeric the First. And also, King Childeric was the son of King Merovich, who was the founder of the Merovingian kings. And also, Catherine links to these families, as it is possible that Catherine Guillaume was a actual descendant of King Philip II of France, of the Capetians, which he was, you know, one of the original Capetians, like the first Capetians back down from Hugh Capet to Robert II, Henry I, Philip I. Louis the Sixth, Louis the Seventh, and then Philip the Second. Boom, boom, boom. And the Capetian dynasty didn't split into different families until it got up to when Philip the Fourth's younger brother, Charles. His Charles's son, Philip, takes the kingship after the death of King Charles the Fourth. And since Charles the Fourth died without producing an heir, since the French monarchy had this law called the Salic Law that prohibits the males from born of the female line of the king to inherit the throne of France, and females were not allowed or prohibited from inheriting the throne as king, as just a sole queen like England has today, like with Queen Elizabeth II. And that's why the French royals were so pressured, the French kings were so pressured to produce a male heir. So it's because of the Salic Law. I actually am a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints now. I converted from the Roman Catholics, and I was able to, but before I became a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, I had a really hard time forgiving those who bullied me and picked on me. I even had a hard time even forgiving my father for the things that he did just before he passed away. But when I found this church, I actually was able to forgive them all, including my father. So, and because of my religion, I actually knew know that if you forgive what others who do wrong to you, then you are able to be forgiven by God. But if you don't forgive others or yourself for the sins that you commit, it is fairly impossible for But I have to forgive you because you have to know how to be able to forgive others to be forgiven, since it does say that in the Lord's Prayer that we must forgive those who trespass against us. Because it says, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And that means being able to forgive those who hurt us, or how we can love our neighbors as ourselves, and love our enemies, and just like what Jesus asked us to do, or just told us to love our enemies, and do to those who to the way you would want them to treat you. So you wanted us to treat other people the way we would want them to treat us. To treat you, yourself. Really nice, and because God is a loving Father that loves all His children here on earth. He loves us all. No matter what, if you reject Him or do everything you can to obey Him, He loves all of His children, no matter what who they are. And that's why He always sent His beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to pay the debt of our sins by dying for us on the cross. And being resurrected from the dead to be able to give us everlasting life. And that's the way I see myself, and also, since I am a French Canadian, I have been trying so hard to learn how to speak my native language of French. Not going all that well, and I'm still mainly in the basics right at the moment, but my mind has a hard time remembering every phrase that I learn by memorizing them once I look at them many times, and it's just like when something is told to me within minutes before, and I go away, and you guys stop talking to me. Everything that you tell me in detail, I actually have a hard time remembering every single detail of what has been said to me. And pretty much, I think that's why I'm having so much trouble remembering everything that I learned from these French books and that I am studying from, and all the French phrases that I have written over the time. But thing is, I can write, I can read and write in French language, but the one thing I have the most problem with is speaking and understanding what is said. Some of the words I know what they mean in English, but since I cannot translate them very well, I have that hard time to learn it, but I am hoping one day I am able to speak my native language of French someday in the future. So I am able to talk to my relatives who still live in Canada. Who speak fluent French, so, and also my grandfather speaks fluent French as well, so, my dad, my mom and dad used to speak French too, like when they were young, and they kind of lost their French kind of thing. English, and they never even introduced the French language to me, my brother, and my sister while we were growing up, so I thank you for listening, and nice day.